The hourglass is a common motif in the art of the Netherlands' somewhat tarnished golden age. It symbolizes mortality and the passing of time. Let's imagine the Netherlands in a pensive mood, pondering the hourglass, the flow of time, the changing climate, extreme rainfall, extreme heat and drought, sinking soil, the rising seas. How will the Netherlands protect its low-lying cities in the long term? Can the polders of its green heart and its Waddenzee islands be secured? Will the sea once again reconfigure the coast? Will all that precious cultural heritage and happy industriousness eventually descend into the narrow funnel of destruction? In moments of reflection, it dawns on the Netherlands that its future can be measured in units of sand and the flow of sediment. For an industrialized, water-based consumer goods conveyance system, I think that's a fair description of what the Dutch have made of the Rhine and the Maas. Sand and sediment are the grit that hinders smooth operation. Remember that tarnished golden age? Colonies and trade, slave trade included, brought an abundance of wealth and goods into Dutch harbors. Dynamic rivers and tidal influx moved sand around in ways that hindered shipping and, from a human perspective, increased flood risk. Building dikes along the river resulted in greater sediment accumulations in downstream estuaries. The sea did its part by silting up harbors, putting profits from international trade at risk. Something had to be done. Enter the dredger, sand and silt remover par excellence. In the 17th century, dredgers were initially powered by human feet, but onboard horses supplied more muscle. A mud mill kept the North Holland Canal clear until the late 19th century. Around that same time, the watermen of Zeeland developed the steam bucket dredger. In the 19th century, this dredger saved the Dutch economy. The dredger in use right now is still saving the Netherlands every day of the week. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you the trailing suction hopper dredger, a triumph of technology. It drags a suction tube along the river or sea bottom, filling the ship's hold, and drops, pumps, or rainbows the sand into a new location. The dredger's promise to keep populations safe. What dredgers do has become essential. Not only do they keep rivers and harbors open for transport, assuming it hasn't been another drought-ridden summer and the Rhine's running on empty, they're also employed in vast maintenance operations all along the Dutch coast. While rivers need to be deepened, which opens them up to storm surges and salt from the sea, beaches and dunes on islands and along the coast erode and are hungry for more sand. Gently sloping beaches with foreshores and high dunes are as integral to the Dutch Delta program as dikes and storm surge barriers. All of them require maintenance. The Dutch are getting smarter about coastal dynamics. They've become sand wizards. By tricking nature into doing some of the heavy lifting, they conjure up beaches and levitate dunes. Take the sand motor. 21 million cubic meters of sand were strategically piled up near an eroding beach. Wind, waves, and currents did the rest, distributing the sand according to their whim, just as the wizard had foreseen. Worldwide, it's regarded as a brilliant example of building with nature. It is. Barrier islands such as Ameland tend to wander. Erosion on one end, accretion on the other. The island of Schiermonnikoog has already crossed the border from one province to the next. To keep islands in place, the Netherlands introduces millions of cubic meters of sand at the eroding end and relies on currents and waves to nourish beaches while winds lift sand onto the dunes. Feeding time? Every 4 years. Meanwhile, there's so much sediment in the system, to keep the shallow channel for the Ameland ferry clear, four dredgers work round the clock. They can't even afford to cut their engines. Sand would clog the works. The Dutch Gold Coast. That's what dredging companies call these island beaches. A less than subtle hint that the Dutch have even colonized themselves. Sea level rise means rising profits, here and abroad, where an appetite for land reclamation fuels demand for sand and dredgers. As for the Netherlands, it reserves massive stores of sand in the midst of the crowded North Sea, where wind energy parks, anchorage areas, crisscrossing cables and pipelines, fisheries, and nature reserves assert their claims too. With each centimeter of sea level rise, the amount of sand required increases. Is this what the Netherlands sees as it peers pensively into the hourglass and contemplates the future? Does it calculate the rising costs, the demands on resources, the destruction of benthic life across the seafloor, the intrusion of salt water in deepen harbors, the intense CO2 emissions from dredging, the layers of measures upon countermeasures, this mad and repetitive cycle, all to maintain its fragile sinking paradise? Does it cast an eye on the sand reserves of the North Sea and wonder, does this make sense? Can our sand wizardry keep pace with the rising sea? Or should we be pondering other options that allow the dynamic flows of sand and sediment to do their work in the Rhine-Maas Delta as well? Reopen to the tides, allow rivers to shallow and nature to flourish. Will the Dutch mend their relationship to river, sand, and sea? We'll be watching. I'm Poldergeist. You know where to find me. I'll be right here, peering beneath the surface. Because when it comes to water and the Dutch, there's more going on than meets the eye.